Is everybody there? Am I?
Yes, everybody's there, and we've got the record mode going.
Okay.
So you can start.
Hello, good afternoon, or good evening, or good morning, or whatever, everybody. I'm going to be spending the next hour or so talking about some fairly old research that I did. And you will have to take it with a pinch of salt as to whether it applies to you or not, or whether it's current or not. I think a fair bit of it is and a fair bit of it isn't, but that's kind of up to you. I got in, unlike Rajan, who got into teaching entrepreneurship by actually doing it, I got into studying and teaching entrepreneurship because I couldn't get a job either in strategy or finance. So my mentor came to me and said, would you teach entrepreneurship? And I said, I don't know anything about entrepreneurship. So he said, well, do you want a job or not? So when he put it like that, I didn't have a whole lot of choice. And I found when I started teaching entrepreneurship that it was a completely horrible experience. And it was a horrible experience because everybody else who had taught entrepreneurship before me was like Rajan, and they had done it, they had war stories, they could speak from deep personal experience. I basically had nothing. And so what I did at that point was I said, let me try to learn something about this. Let me try to learn about entrepreneurship in as systematic a fashion as I could. And I had worked at McKinsey before, so I knew something about doing relatively large-scale systematic research. And so I said, what do successful entrepreneurs do? And not just sort of a few of my friends, but broadly speaking. It turns out, for better or for worse, that it is extremely hard to generalize about entrepreneurs. They come in all kinds of shapes and sizes. They vary by industry. I'm pretty certain they vary by country. But I happen to study what I call promising startups based in the United States. This is a class of startups that have certain characteristics. Once upon a time, I used to believe that these were the common characteristics to all startups and all successful businesses. I do not believe that anymore. So take what I say as a characterization of a particular important genre of startups that I studied in the late 80s and early 90s. And you can decide for yourself which of these patterns are applicable to what you want to do and where you want to do it. So that's by way of preamble. So this presentation is it summarizes research that I did, A, to teach myself how to teach entrepreneurship, and B, it became the foundation of a book which I wrote called The Origin and Evolution of New Businesses. It's a big, fat, thick book. If you throw it at people, it can cause bodily harm. And if you have difficulty sleeping, you might want to look at it one day. So let me provide a fairly simple framework for categorizing some important classes of innovative or entrepreneurial activity. And my claim is that there's lots of innovative or entrepreneurial activity in the world, and it's quite different, but it tends to cluster along this diagonal, which is that entrepreneurial ventures which require a lot of investment typically are not terribly novel. And ventures which are extremely novel typically are started without a great deal of investment. So as you can see in this slide, I'm suggesting that there is there's an inverse relationship between novelty and investment, and there's also sort of a third dimension to this, which is complexity. So things generally, highly novel things start off being relatively simple. This may seem paradoxical to you, but bear with me. when I offer you a couple of examples, you may get a sense of what I'm talking about. The second claim that I have is that there is a kind of organizational specialization along this novelty investment relationship. At one end, where there's a great deal of novelty and very little investment, are startups of the sort that Microsoft was when it launched Basic in 1975. But basically, there was no money involved in the process at all. Nobody had the slightest idea what the market for personal computers was going to be. The idea of personal computing itself was incredibly novel. On the other side, think of Microsoft as, I could update these slides, I haven't done it, but you could think of Windows 10 today. So that's, I mean, it has a number of novel features, but basically the idea of an operating system, the idea of a personal computer operating system, the personal computer market is incredibly well established. And whereas the old Microsoft Basic started with virtually very little money, you'll see that something like the launch of Windows 10 involves billions of dollars, sometimes tens of billions of dollars. And you also see that the products themselves tend to be much more complex. So Microsoft Basic was basically a relatively small number of lines of code, and that just sold by these two guys to one particular buyer. Windows 10 is incredibly complex. It's complex technologically, it's complex in how it's sold, it's complex in how it's marketed, it's complex in its interactions with regulatory agencies. And then somewhere in between are ventures which are launched by what one might think of as transitional firms. So imagine Microsoft's launching Excel in 1985, or ventures launched by venture capitalists, or ventures launched by wealthy angels. So you can think of Sun Microsystems in 1982 as occupying this middle space. My other claim is that the kinds of challenges and the kinds of approaches people need to have vary along this novelty investment dimension. So when you are starting something which requires, which involves a great deal of novelty, not much investment. For instance, strategy is not a big deal. I mean, people talk about strategy. What these entrepreneurs tend to use is much more what I will call opportunistic adaptation, and I will get back to you. I'll have more to say about opportunistic adaptation as we go along. Things like face-to-face selling are absolutely crucial. Face-to-face selling by the entrepreneur are absolutely crucial for those kinds of ventures. As you get into something like a Windows 10, then things like planning, strategy, and teamwork become absolutely crucial. Because these are large, complex projects. They cannot be done on the fly. They need all kinds of good project management techniques. It cannot be done by one individual or a small group of individuals. A lot of things have to come together. So what you need to launch an entrepreneurial venture on the northwestern part of my axis is very different from what you have or need on the southeastern part of this axis. So where does all this come from? I mean, I have, like I said, virtually no personal experience of this. Most of this has been done through research. And my research comes from the following categories. Inc. magazine, which some of you may or may be familiar with, those of you who are in the United States, but if you're not from the United States, Inc. was a magazine which was launched primarily to serve young up-and-coming companies, because that was a niche which was not being filled. And almost as a marketing gimmick, they started this list of the Inc. 500. I mean, there was the Fortune 500, the Forbes 500. These were all sort of large company ranking list. So they said there's nothing like this for entrepreneurs. So why don't we put together a list of the 500 fastest growing companies in the United States? And it turned out that everybody wanted to be on the list because it was good publicity if you were an entrepreneur to call yourself an Inc. 500 company. And so this became a badge of honor. And I studied 100 of 500 companies on the 1989 Inc. 500 list. So that's my base research. And it was a grueling, extended piece of research because I spoke to each one of them 2 or 3 hours at a stretch. They were spread all over the country. And it was a fairly mammoth undertaking. So mammoth that nobody's done anything before or since. And this is sort of like my barrier to entry in business. To what degree this pattern that I found in the Inc. 500 were common to other entrepreneurs in the United States, I surveyed another 100 entrepreneurs who were alums of Harvard Business School. And basically, I took the list of Harvard Business School alums, found out everyone who claimed to be self-employed, and I asked them more or less the same questions that I had ended up documenting with the Inc. 500 companies. But these were not face-to-face surveys. Then I took advantage of what every good professor should take advantage of, which is the free labor of his students. And I got my students to write instead of a final exam, because writing final exams is incredibly dull and to both give and to read. I said, why don't you go out and write a critical history of a successful entrepreneur? And you can do this in groups of 2 or 3. And over the years, I think I now have, this is an old, I actually need to update this presentation. I think I have about 1,000 critical biographies now. And so it's, again, principally US-based, but some from abroad as well. In addition, I have done 20 very detailed case studies, and these tend to be even more detailed than the interviews that I had done with the Inc. 500 founders. So that's basically what I know. I should emphasize that with the exception of the critical biographies, this is almost exclusively an American database. There was a time shortly after I wrote my book, I went around the world and I gave these presentations, and at the end of my talk, someone would put up his hand and say, hey, you're describing me, you're describing my business, this is exactly how I did it. And then I patted myself on the back and I said, wow, I have come up with a model that is universal. And then I spent a couple of years researching companies in Bangalore. And I realized, no, this is not at all universal. How small businesses get started in Bangalore is extremely different. And the reason why these people had put up their hands and said, your business is exactly like mine, is that everywhere you'll find someone. And the people whose businesses were not like mine, they just kept their hands down. And the people whose businesses were like mine put their hands up. So I have become, through this experience, especially after my research in Bangalore, very, very skeptical about the notion of to what degree one can generalize across geographies and across industries and across times. So today I'm going to focus principally on what I call promising startups. And it's an awkward phrase, but I haven't been able to come up with something much better. But think of it this way. In the United States, there are, depending on the year, somewhere between 700,000 to 1 million new businesses launched each year. Roughly that. I mean, this tends to vary with the business cycle and so forth. Of these 700 to 1 million businesses launched every year, no more than a few hundred are funded by venture capitalists. You can think of these as the creme de la creme, the sort of less than half of 1% of these of the population of startups. Now, the great mass of businesses that are started are pretty much barber shops and the little corner grocery store or someone who's doing house painting. And these are not businesses that are actually going to go anywhere. So I don't know what percentage of that million these kinds of business are, but let's say it's of the order of 80 to 90%. So the businesses that I'm interested in are the ones that occupy that slice in between, which is that they are neither these venture capital backed businesses, nor are they the barbershop or the hairdressing salon or the local tea shop. These are what I call promising startups. So I'm going to spend most of my time talking about these promising startups, and I'll just sort of by way of contrast, I'll show you how these promising startups are different from corporate initiatives. So it's always good to start with a story and to make what you're talking about vivid. So my story is about two engineers in the proverbial garage, and they have between them about $500 in capital. They've recently graduated from college, so they figured out they don't really want to work for anyone. They have this urge to start a business. They don't quite know what business it will be, so the first thing they try is to develop. I mean, they're trained engineers, so they try to develop a foot fault indicator for tennis, and that doesn't go so well. Then they decide they're going to build a harmonica tuner. You know, there are piano tuners. Why not a harmonica tuner? That doesn't go so well either. Then they said, let's build an audio oscillator. So they build an audio oscillator. They don't quite know the price it. These are, after all, two engineers who have not taken any business or entrepreneurship courses. So they should arbitrarily price it at $54.40, which they get from the slogan used to establish the U.S. border in the Pacific Northwest, which was 54-40 or fight. As it happens, they can't really produce this thing for $54.40, so they're selling this at a loss. Luckily, the nearest competing product is selling for $250, so they can raise their price and they somehow survive. And out of this company emerges the company that we now call Hewlett Packard, right? And so that's my sort of classic story. You can contrast this with what one might call the big money paradigm. And these slides are slightly dated, but I'm sure you could find current examples. So the big money paradigm has experienced founders. They do careful market research, more or less. They write a business plan. They assemble a top-notch team, sort of people who have been there, done that, have a great deal of experience. They typically will raise venture capital. This combination of venture capital, this combination of founders, market research, business plan, et cetera, will lead to sustainable advantages. And then bingo, IPO is sort of that's sort of like a good progression that you see under what I would call the big money paradigm. And surely there are lots of good examples of this. And again, I apologize for my dated slides, but there's this company called Compaq Computer. It was started by three veterans who, between them, had 30 or 40 years of experience in the computer industry. They had an audacious plan to take on IBM, nothing small. They went to Ben Rosen, one of the early venture capitalists, raised what was at the time the munificent sum of $20 million. They hired experienced managers, and in their very first year of being in business, they clocked about $100 million in sales. And you know, there are other examples. There's Lotus Development Corp, there's Genentech, there's Sun Microsystems, there's Staples. But as again, and these are the things which capture a lot of people's attention and fancy. But in my observation, the number of these high-end startups, these big money startups, just swamped by the very large number of much smaller companies that do not start up like that. So Hewlett-Packard did not start up like that. Walmart didn't start up like that. Magazine, Rolling Stone didn't start up like that. UPS didn't start up like that. Dell didn't start up like that. Cisco didn't start up like that. And basically, most of the Inc. 500 companies that I studied did not start up like that. So how did they start up? So I found the following patterns in these promising improvised startups. First of all, it's important to notice what they don't have and what they don't have and what limits their opportunities. One thing that they don't have is they typically don't have a track record. These are like Mr. Hewlett and Mr. Packard, sort of a couple of years out of college, or Bill Gates or Paul Allen, who not even completed college, or Michael Dell, who is, you know. So these are basically, at the time, nobodies. They may or may not have a college degree. They certainly don't have a degree of credible industry experience or knowledge. Interestingly, they typically do not have any breakthrough ideas as well. In my sample of Inc. 500 companies, more than half basically just copied a previous employer's idea. Or to the degree that they did not copy a previous employer's idea, they were providing what one would call an undifferentiated response to an opportunity. So this is now, we're talking about prehistory, but when some of you may know the founding story of Microsoft. So the founding story of Microsoft is, and this is something which I think everybody should know because we use personal computers, that in 1975, a picture of the first personal computer appeared on the cover of Popular Mechanics magazine. And Paul Allen, who had come to visit Bill Gates, saw this cover and said, "Wow, this is a new thing. And a new thing, it's a computer. And it has no software, it didn't have an operating system. Let's write a basic programming language for the computer." And so they did. But the interesting thing is that they were not the only two people who thought of that. I mean, there were sort of thousands or tens of thousands of people who saw that cover. And there were happened to be about 20 or 30 people who also wrote a basic for the computer. So, and this happens over and over again. So when, you know, when the web got started, a lot of people said, "Aha, we can now port our software, which we had been previously doing on microprocessors onto the web," or when the iPhone took off, there are a bunch of people all basically doing more or less the same thing, even if they weren't copying it from their employers. Of the people I interviewed, I said, how many of you have a product that is so unique that there are no substitutes for it?" And 94% said, no, there are things which are more or less exact substitutes. And of my 100, of the 100 people that I studied, only 3 of them had any patents filed. By the way, I think I told you earlier that I've had my students write critical biographies of successful entrepreneurs, and these tend to be high profile, better known ventures than the ones I studied. Even there, you pretty much see the same pattern. So if you think of Walmart was not by any way a novel idea, and it had no proprietary technology, and I can go down the complete list. And so this is by no means uncommon. But the combination of being barely out of school, if that, and not having a novel idea, is that you can't raise professional capital. I mean, what do you have to show a VC when you are in that position? So in my Inc. 500 startups, basically 80% of them were self-financed. And they're not self-financed by people who were already wealthy and successful and could put in a ton of money into the startups. The median startup capital for my sample was $10,000. that may seem like a large sum of money to people outside the United States, but within the United States, it's basically nothing. It's like a fourth of the starting salary of a freshly minted college graduate. Less than 5% of these Inc. 500 companies that I studied raised venture capital funding. The combination of not having much money and not having a great idea meant that these people pretty much had to focus on niche markets. So Compaq, as I said earlier, started off taking on IBM, but you know that was not a niche market. Sun Microsystems, when it got started, it also said we're going to take on IBM and we're going to take on digital. But these kinds of companies are again the exception to the rule. So 60% of the companies I interviewed were serving local markets, not even national markets. They're basically competing against other small companies. So in my Inc. 500 sample, about 73% of them were competing against small companies, you know, the startups another 5% were competing against mid-sized companies. The number that were competing against Fortune 500 companies was really tiny indeed. But the interesting thing is that these were not uniformly distributed across the economy as a whole. So it isn't as if there's sort of this large thing called the economy, the randomly large number of startups getting started, and by chance some of them succeed. No, there seemed to be a systematic pattern. So for instance, there were many sectors that were completely excluded from the Inc. 500 list. So for instance, there were no mining companies, there were no textile companies, there were no companies in process industries. Interestingly, and there was only one company that was remotely connected to automobiles, and this is a brake remanufacturing company. Now, if you look at startups in the United States, there are a ton of companies that are startups that are related to automobiles. I mean, the garages, the paint, the people who do paint jobs, the people who run petrol pumps and gas stations. So there are a very large number, but somehow these startups in the automobile sector, broadly defined, do not, except this one, do not end up on the Inc. 500 list. There are no hotels or airlines on the list. There's only one restaurant, a pizza shop. And again, restauranting is an incredibly common pathway to entrepreneurship, but it does not seem to be an easy path to getting onto the Inc. 500 list. There's only one biotechnology company. If you contrast this with venture capital-backed companies, sort of the cream of the crop, as it were, something like 30% of a venture capitalist portfolio tends to be in biotechnology. But these biotechnology companies are not on the Inc. 500. So it's a particular creature. A very large proportion of them were concentrated in the IT industry. So the bottom blue line is, those of you who are in the IT industry tend to think that the earth begins and ends with the IT sector. If you actually look at what proportion of the economy as a whole IT accounts for, it's a relatively small proportion. So it tends to be between 5 to 8% of the economy. But on that Inc. 500 list, the proportion of companies in the IT sector broadly defined was something like 5 to 6 times the proportion in the economy. So there's something going on here. The other interesting thing was that most of these companies were not selling low-end consumer products, nor were they, very few of them were selling very high-end consumer products. They were selling largely high-ticket items, somewhere between the hundreds or the thousands of dollars. The median sale of my company was about $5,000, remember I told you the median capital was $10,000. So the median sale was about half of the money that they raised to get that business going. I do not include the average because the average was skewed by a company that was launching satellites. That would raise the average a lot. This combination of selling high ticket products and services meant that 90% of the entrepreneurs I studied were engaged in direct sales, and only 10% of them were selling through brokers, dealers, distribution channels, or whatever. So most of these things were sold to the final customer directly by the startup. And again, interestingly, if you read the business press and you read about entrepreneurship, it's typically about consumer goods and services. And the reason it's about consumer goods and services is because these are fun stories to tell. But the actual action tends to be in business to business. And 86% of the companies that I started were selling business to business stuff. Contrast this with what I think of as sort of the low end startups. This is a list of quote unquote popular startups in 1996, and these are what you can imagine. You can expect them to be the construction contractors, the restaurants, the retail stores, the cleaning services, the property brokers, the real estate brokers, the automotive service and repair. So there's something fundamentally different between these promising startups, between the venture capital backed startups on the one hand and these low-end startups on the other. And what might that be? And my proposition is that entrepreneurs who start off with meager resources, which is to say they don't have a lot of human capital and they don't have a novel idea, tend to thrive in novel rather than settled niches. And the example of that is the computer industry, because the computer industry has been more or less in a constant state of flux since 1975. I mean, the specific architectures and platforms have changed, but it has been in a state of flux. What the state of flux does is that it creates a head's eye, it creates either pure arbitrage or it creates a head's eye when tails I don't lose much kind of proposition. So my favorite story of pure arbitrage is I interviewed these two kids based in Florida, and this was in the early 80s. Their business idea was to take the cable that you need to connect printers to computers. We all know that. And so you need printer cables for that. And in the early days, it was sort of like a relatively novelty item. And they figured out that they could buy these cables in bulk and snip them up into 3 foot or 1 meter lengths and sell for $20 what it cost them a dollar. That was basically their business idea. And this was not even an original business idea. It was an idea that they'd seen their boss do, and they said, hey, we too can cut computer cable. What's the big deal here? Or if it's not pure arbitrage, it's heads I win, tails I don't lose very much. So think of Gates and Allen in 1975. What the heck did they have to lose? They weren't giving up jobs. They weren't putting up capital. They were doing this on the side. And if it had failed, he would have, Gates would have applied to business school and written in his essay how he tried to start a software company. So that's the sort of thing that you get when you are in a market which is in the state of flux. So, I am in the end a professor, so I like to draw these probability diagrams and so forth. So if you think of your standard marginal startup, the probability, the mean probability is pretty close to zero. And the probability that it will make much more or much less than zero is also extremely low. So these are the typical marginal startups. The promising startups, the mean probability is still zero. So the 20 people who tried to write basic for the Altair, 19 of them got zero. But there's a skew. And the skew means that if you lose, you don't lose very much. But if you win, there's the potential in the long run of making a boatload of money. And you also don't know what these probabilities are. So that's the fundamental difference. A second important feature, and I mentioned this right in the beginning, is the degree to which these startups rely on what I had called opportunistic adaptation versus planning. So it's a very ad hoc process, this business of, you know, of Hewlett and Packard starting a business or Gates and Allen starting a business. It typically does not arise through a systematic search for business opportunities. Sort of only 4% of the companies that I interviewed got their business idea through a systematic search. Some 71% replicated or modified an idea that they'd encountered through their previous employment, and some 20% of them discovered this by chance. You know, they wanted it. It was a product they wanted as an individual consumer. One person saw it on his honeymoon. Another person developed an idea from his family. So it's not a systematic process, nor is it a planned process. So in the less than 30% of the companies that I interviewed had a business plan, and 41% had no business plan at all. 26% had what one would call a rudimentary business plan, and 5% said we drew up some pro forma projections for a bank of for investors. These were few and far between. What are they? Why is this? I mean, you know, I've been at a consulting firm before, and I teach at a business school, so planning has been historically my bread and butter. So I'm not going to argue that planning and research is always a bad idea, or it's a bad idea for all startups. I'm merely saying for the kind of startups that I studied, the costs of planning tend to be greater than the benefits. And why is that? One is that, like I said, these are businesses getting started in extremely novel markets. And in these novel markets, the data is extremely limited. You do not know who your customers are or who your competitors are. And delays are extremely costly, because the opportunities that you're trying to pursue are fleeting. If you spend any time trying to do systematic research, the opportunity would be gone. The second reason why planning doesn't make sense for these kinds of businesses is that they don't have much capital. So how much, if you're starting with $10,000, what are you going to spend on planning or research? The third reason is that there's very little downside. These are not businesses that are investing in any major infrastructure, that they don't have any large software development project. Just getting started with very little downside and very little risk. And so what these companies do instead is rely on opportunistic adaptation. And I think that's best illustrated through a story. And the story is of a company that I interviewed called Eagle Brook Plastics. It was started by two chemical engineers from Purdue who were sort of employed by a large chemical company, which is to say that they had jobs and they got paychecks, but they didn't have to do more than a couple of hours of work a day. So in the rest of that time, they decided they'd become brokers for scrap plastic. I mean, you know, very rudimentary business. Then they said, aha, let's add some value. So they bought themselves a $700 grinder. Then they moved up the value chain and they bought themselves a $25,000 grinder. And then they said, oh, but we also have a chemical engineering degree, so let's do something useful with it. So they came up with a process for purifying paper contaminated scrap. Paper contaminated scrap was cheap compared to clean scrap. So they could make some money this way. Then they got into the business of recycling plastic bottles. They went from recycling plastic bottles to making plastic lumber. Then they went from there to styrofoam recycling. And they are now the largest styrofoam recycler in the United States. Now, if you look at this progression, there's no planning in this. I mean, it's not the unfolding of a vision. There's no plan. It's just one thing leading to another. And it's also a progression that could not have been planned. So these two guys could not have started in 1983 and say, our goal is to become the largest styrofoam recycler in the country. It had to be a process of discovery, step by step by step. As you encounter opportunities, you adapt to them. The third, and I think the really crucial part of these kinds of businesses, is how they face the challenge of getting resources. And by resources, I want to principally talk about customers, employees, and suppliers, much less so about capital, because like I said, these guys couldn't get much capital. There's someone who has said that startups face the liability of newness, which it isn't that their product is any worse than the existing product, or they're not. It is of lower quality. There's just sort of a human aversion to dealing with a new supplier or a new vendor. And overcoming this liability of newness was sort of the principal challenge for these entrepreneurs. If you discover a cure for cancer, you're good, because you know you have something that everybody desperately needs and nobody else has. But if you are one of 20 people doing more or less the same thing, you're in quite a different problem. So how do you overcome this liability of humans when you don't have much capital? So one thing a lot of these entrepreneurs did was to offer special deals and benefits to the first customer. So yes, we understand we've not been around for a while and we're new and so on and so forth. We'll do something extra for you. And the interesting thing, again, it's worth noting, because we are now in an age where a lot of startups raise billions of dollars in capital and give away stuff for free. These deals were not giving away stuff for free, because these entrepreneurs could not afford to give away stuff for free. But they'd do something extra. So they would, perhaps they'd sell you software to manage your portfolio. And they'd say, we understand you don't know how to use computers. We'll come and train you how to use them. It's stuff like that. The second, and I cannot emphasize this enough, it has become ingrained. The quality of their salesmanship was just absolutely crucial. This is what would make or break these companies. So if you ask what differentiated Gates and Allen from the other 19 people who are also doing the basic from the altar, it was that Gates and Allen could sell their stuff. And what did this salesmanship entail? One was that it entailed mimicry. It was entailed taking on the look and feel of an established company. So when Hewlett and Packard were selling their audio oscillator, they decided to call their model the Model 200A, because they said if we call it the Model 200A, people might imagine that there must have been a Model 100 before that, and therefore we must be an established company. So a lot of these businesses were operating locally, but they had international or global or some such random thing in their name. The second thing that they did was to take advantage of this phenomenon called framing. The idea of framing has been established in the social science literature and in the social psychology literature, and it goes something like this. In standard decision theory, people are supposed to make the same decision no matter how it's framed. But in real life, framing is absolutely crucial. So if you go to a patient and say, if you have such and such elective surgery, there's a 70% chance that you will get well and things will be very good. Do you want to have the elective surgery or not? Many more people tend to opt for the elective surgery than if you present the same data and say, if you have the surgery, there's a 30% chance you will die. Somehow, if you present it in the second fashion, people tend not to be terribly interested in your proposition. So what these entrepreneurs were really good at was not actually lying, but presenting their proposition in a fashion which put the spotlight on the benefits you would get and more or less downplayed the downside. The third interesting aspect of their salesmanship was to get incremental commitments from people. And again, this is a phenomenon from social psychology. If I buy a little something from you, then I'm emotionally invested in you. And just to prove that I did not make a wrong decision in buying that little something, I'm then prepared to buy the next something from you. Just because that is human nature. So if you want to sell me something, do not come to me with something which is off the bat an expensive, risky proposition. Sell me something which doesn't seem like a big deal at the time. And then, just for psychological reasons, I will then be prone to buying more stuff from you. So the idea is to get a small yes for a small thing first, and then you can start getting bigger yeses. For all that, these, not everybody falls for mimicry, not everybody falls for framing, not everybody falls for incremental commitments. There was a lot of searching before they could buy, before the key would fit the lock. So, but the important thing was that since these people were in business to business ventures, and since the median sale was roughly half of the cost of their startup capital, it didn't require a lot of sales before you could cover your startup costs. And then finally, they made do with second tier resources. Now, at business schools, when we are trying to teach students how to start a business, we say you mustn't just get any old source of capital. You must get strategically valuable capital. You mustn't get any customers you get must get strategic customers. So you mustn't get just people to work for you. You must get absolutely the best team you can to get to work with. So this is very good advice if you can do it. But unfortunately, there are very few people who can actually do it. I mean, so if you have a great idea, you have a lot of, you have a great track record behind you, you come from a brand name institution, then maybe you can get first year resources. But the typical entrepreneur cannot. What does the typical entrepreneur do? The typical entrepreneur makes do with whatever he can get. So this is Dr. John Greenwood. We said we were careful to make sure that we only employed people who are unemployed. Not unemployable, but unemployed. We did this for one reason. One reason was we were cheap. Two, for conscience reasons. If it didn't work out for them, we wouldn't feel so bad. Another guy was renting balloons. Yes, there are businesses that get started renting balloons. And he said to get hired into this organization was a joke. I mean, if you came in and we needed a warm body, you were hired, literally for any position. Our turnover was high because we had to fire many employees. Grounds for termination were a bad attitude and undermining the company. He said, Bob, what is a bad attitude and undermining the company? He said, you know, bad attitude, undermining the company. So I said, no, come, really tell me what was it? He said, well, if truth be told, half our employees were stealing the merchandise and selling it to their competitors. And that's a bad attitude and it undermines the company. And I said, yes, indeed. So it's interesting. If you go to Silicon Valley, if you go to these venture capital backed companies, nobody talks about employees actually stealing merchandise or cash. I mean, they might steal post-it notes. If you go talk to these Inc. 500 companies, this is a big concern, which is employees stealing money. And it is a big concern because in Silicon Valley, you get sort of these top-notch engineering types of people who went to good schools and they're in it for their options. That's not the way much of the world works. In much of the world works, you work with who can get. I suspect many of you have seen this picture. Yes, Rajan, do you think many people have seen this picture or not?
I saw it for the first time when I was going through a pitch.
Okay. So it's basically the...
But I didn't recognize Bill.
This is the early picture of Microsoft employees. The guy to the extreme left in the long hair and the blue shirt is Bill Gates. The guy to the extreme right is Paul Allen. Now, the interesting thing is that the guys in between did not have degrees from Stanford or MIT or Caltech. These are basically programmers off the street. They did not have stock options. They were working because they needed jobs. And they took an enormous amount of abuse from Bill Gates because that's how it was. And I think if you found similar pictures of early company of the early employees of Dell or the early employees of Cisco, you'd find pretty much the same kind of thing. The fourth and the last thing I'm going to talk about these kinds of these entrepreneurs is what are the personality traits of the entrepreneur. This is a favorite topic for people who do entrepreneurship research. There must be some entrepreneurial personality. And there's been a ton of research done on the subject, and people have looked for need for achievement, breaking propensity, blah, blah, blah. It's a very long list. But if you actually look at the data, the results are completely unconvincing. So people have not really been able to find convincing evidence that there is such a thing as an entrepreneurial personality, generally defined. And the reason I think is pretty simple. Someone who's starting a biotech company or someone who's starting a big data company is going may well be quite a different person from someone who's starting a little newspaper stand. And yet both of them technically are called entrepreneurs. And so I think it is a fruitless task to say what is an entrepreneur in general. Well, I can offer you some inferences about the particular kinds of entrepreneurs that I have, that I studied, these promising entrepreneurs, based on the kinds of tasks that to perform. So what might one infer from the general picture that I've described to you? Why is it that lots of people may have seen this cover of Popular Mechanics magazine? Why did only Gates and Allen and 19 other people try to write a basic one? A lot of people potentially could have. One reason is that there seems to be an optimal level of human capital and backgrounds that lead to people trying to start these promising businesses. So in the United States, roughly 30% of the population has college degrees. But in my Inc. 500 list, 81% of them had college degrees. There's this sort of, there's this nice image of the person who comes from a starving family and builds a business. My father sort of might have fit that category. But that's not typical. The typical person who's starting this kind of business tends to be middle class. And this is, again, not an accident. Because as you may or may not know, Gates and Allen both went to one of the poshest private schools in Seattle. And because they went to this posh school, this was a school which was amongst the first in the United States to have computers. So they were exposed to computers early on. Gates's father was a top-notch lawyer in Seattle. So someone who is has that kind of background isn't going to start a garage, isn't going to become a car mechanic, isn't going to become a newspaper vendor, isn't going to become a tea stall vendor. The natural inclination is going to go to doing something more interesting than that. On the other hand, if they're also extremely wealthy, if your father is, Bill Gates' children are not going to start companies if they do get into entrepreneurship. They're not going to start businesses like the way Bill Gates start. They probably go for a venture capital backed business or something big. In psychological terms, what might one infer these individuals who had a propensity to start these promising businesses had? They did not, I would argue, have or need a high tolerance for risk. Because they were not really taking any risk to speak of. They've been fired, they could get jobs. But what they had was this tolerance for ambiguity. And tolerance for ambiguity is quite a different mindset than tolerance for risk. The classic experiment for ambiguity is the following. There are two bottles. One bottle has 52 jars. One jar has 50 black balls and 50 red balls, and the other jar has an unknown number of red or black balls. You don't quite know what it is. And if you draw a black ball, you get 50 cents, or you get a dollar. If you draw a red ball, you get nothing. And people are asked, which of these two jars do you want to draw from? And the classic answer, if you have been properly trained in the decision sciences, is to be, I'm indifferent between these two jars, because what do I know? The other jar probably has the same distribution of red and black balls, and I can't tell. Strangely enough, when you do this experiment, virtually everyone wants to draw from that 50-50 jar. And then if you ask them, how much are you willing to pay to draw from that 50-50 jar as opposed to drawing from the other jar, the average willingness to pay is about 36 cents, which is completely astonishing. Because the expected value of the draw itself is only 50 cents. So people are willing to give away 72% of the expected value simply to not get into a situation where they don't know what the odds are. And I think that is a common feature of human nature, which is that most of us, and I will include myself in that lot, we want to know what the risks and returns are. We want to have some sense of probabilities. It is the unusual person who has this tolerance for ambiguity, and it is the unusual person, therefore, who is willing to start this kind of promising business. I don't think, by the way, the same degree of ambiguity tolerance is necessary for a venture capital-backed startup, because with a venture capital-backed startup, you sort of have a good team behind you, you know, you have some sense of what the market is, you have good capital behind you. But in this kind of business, tolerance for ambiguity is key. What else is potentially important? What is important, for instance, for adaptation? You need this quality of decisiveness. Decisiveness in the face of a black unknown of what is likely to happen. And you also need a sense of open-mindedness. And this leads to an enormous amount of internal conflict. If you work for a large company, there is a division of labor over there. Sort of, you can be the product champion, and then you have the boss, and the boss's job is to raise questions and doubts about why your project won't work. And through that process of raising questions and doubts, the project actually improves. If you're starting a business which requires venture capital, you can be the gung-ho entrepreneur, and then it's the venture capitalist's job to be the voice of reason, the voice of skepticism, and so forth. But if you're starting a business where you don't have any external capital and you are entirely your own person, you have to be that schizophrenic person where on the one side, you have to be incredibly confident, you have to be incredibly sure that this is going to work. But there's a part of you which has to be willing to change direction very quickly. And this can create an enormous amount of internal emotional stress. And not everyone is capable of dealing with that emotional stress. You need a great deal in terms of securing resources, you need a great deal of tactical ingenuity. Like I said, these are not very creative businesses per se in terms of the basic idea. But in terms of selling, people don't want to see you. And you have to figure out, you have something you want to sell and the door shuts on you. And how do you... How do you get the door open? This is not creativity with a big C. This is creativity with a small C. What little excuses, what little tricks can you play? You also need an enormous amount of self-control. Now Bill Gates has become an elder statesman, and everybody talks about the Gates Foundation and so forth. But through his middle age, he was a man with a violent temper. And he would shout you out, and he would tell you you're a fool and an idiot and so on and so forth. But you have to believe that when Bill Gates went on the sales calls to people like IBM, he kept that self-control, he kept the temper under enormous self-control. So most of these entrepreneurs have enormous egos, because you wouldn't do this without an ego. But when they go to sell something, it is always a yes, sir. And you have to be willing to be slapped around. You have to be willing to be told your product is useless, you are useless, and you just have a smile on your face and you keep going. Even though you have every reason to believe that the person that you are selling to is not as smart or as capable as you are. That's where the self-control comes in. Whereas I'm a professor, I can tell my students that they're not terribly smart. And it doesn't work in an entrepreneurial situation. Many of these entrepreneurs are, shall we say, selfish. I think there's a certain degree of selfishness which goes hand in hand with these individuals that I interviewed. But even if they are selfish, even if they are primarily looking out for themselves, they have to have the capacity to put themselves in the other person's shoes. Because raw selfishness, where you cannot understand what is making the other person tick, isn't going to get you very far. So this allocentric orientation, understand what the other person is thinking, understand what that person's fears and hopes are, is crucial. And then finally, if you ask me, what technical skill or what learned skill do these people need? I would say it is primarily sales skill. It is not marketing because these people are not really doing any marketing in the classic sense of the word. It's not finance because they're not raising and they're not raising much capital. It's not team building or teamwork because it's just basically them and a few people whom they've used. It is selling. So it's interesting to contrast these critical traits and skills which you need at the start of a business with what has been talked about in some of the entrepreneurial literature: this tolerance for risk, breakthrough ideas, vision, grand ambition, charisma, using power, administrative skills. And I think I've often asked myself, where does this mythology on the right-hand side of the screen come from? And I think it comes from the fact that the traits and skills that are important to starting a business are not necessarily the traits and skills that are important or necessary in building a business. And one sort of lumps all these things together. And it is frequently the case that people who are good at starting businesses don't have these other things. So when you're starting a business, you have no power, so using power is not a big deal. You're going to build a business, your capacity to marshal power, or your capacity to be a good administrator or a good manager does come to the fore. But that's the story for a different day. So let me just summarize my propositions about promising startups, which is entrepreneurs with meager endowments tend to have lack breakthrough ideas, have limited verifiable capital, don't have the unavailability of outside funding, tend to thrive in businesses which involve low investment, high uncertainty, low likely profit. There they face the tasks of opportunist adaptation and securing resources. And for this, these are that in a nutshell is my summary of what promising startups are like. I can now, I don't know how much time we have because it's getting but I can now contrast this with the initiatives of large companies. Or how much time do we have, Raj?
Yeah, I think we should wrap up in about 5 or 10 minutes, basically by answering questions.
Okay, so then I won't do.
No, I think keep the contrast this slide because I think it's a fabulous summary slide.
Okay,
and I think I've already got a bunch of questions that I've listed. One is from the traits and skills. I was looking at that, and I'm thinking, you know, at least in Silicon Valley, in the founding team, Jews and Indians, for some reason, seem to dominate.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm wondering what it is about the traits and skills, or I think we are definitely entrepreneurs with meager endowments. But I'm thinking of, you know, what traits and skills have tilted the favor in terms for Jews and Indians.
Okay.
And then the second question I had was, entrepreneurship is really kind of become very popular in India. I think we've not seen major successes as yet besides in the outsourcing area.
Mm-hmm.
But, right now there is a whole wave of entrepreneurship activity going on in India, and you know, I see it when I go to India to teach, and I'm seeing all the Thai chapters, seeing a lot of interest in entrepreneurship. And based on your US experience and your any thoughts on that?
Okay, so let me take up the first question, and okay. I cannot say much about Jews, but the question of Indians is an interesting one. And in particular, I had started on this research project, and I had the hypothesis So it's interesting to think of just people who went to IIT and came to the States, because that is now controlling for a variety of things. It's controlling for a certain amount of technical ability.
Right.
Pretty much everyone who comes from the same sort of technical skill.
Sure.
And no one has any capital when they come here, more or less.
Right.
And no one has any particular social network when they come here.
Yeah. Right?
Whereas in India, you can say, well, the Marwadis have an internal network, they know who to buy from and they know to sell from. So everybody's sort of starting on more or less clean slate.
Mm-hmm.
And it was my casual hypothesis. I never got around to being able to establish this, that people who were successful amongst IITs, starting businesses in the United States, either came from business castes or business states, Gujaratis, Punjabis, Marwadis being sort of the classic example, or they came from English medium schools. And often people where there was an overlap between these two things. And I think the only way I can explain it is that it's probably monkey see, monkey do in some sense. If you've come from a milieu where if not your direct parents, a bunch of relatives have been in business, it is not unnatural for you to think of going to business in the first place. And you also have the sort of the social self-confidence that I can cope with people. And this is where, again, I think the English speaking part of it comes in. I don't know about the Jewish side of it, and I suspect if you dug into the into the Jewish milieu, you'd find maybe it's not all Jews, maybe it's some proportion of them, etc. But I really cannot speak of it. One more interesting observation, and this gets away from the promising startups. I did do another study of venture capital back then.
Mm-hmm.
And there I looked at the proportion of immigrants in these venture capital back then. So if you just looked at the proportion of immigrants and you looked at the proportion of, say, Indians, you'd say, wow, this is a really large number. But if you then controlled for PhDs in engineering, or masters in engineering, we found that Indians were actually underrepresented as a proportion of Indians so the typical Indian who comes here to do a PhD in engineering wants a job with a government lab. and controlling for having a PhD in engineering, it's the American who's more likely to be. And it just so happens that not a lot of Americans want to do PhDs in engineering, so that's why that base rate is small. So things are complex.
Okay.
I see a question here. Can we have access to the biographies that you have compiled? So some of the biographies are in my book, but the much larger number of them, the one put together by my students, were compiled into a 700-page document whose copyright sits with Harvard Business School. And if you can persuade them to disgorge it, good luck to you. It is just it's madness, but I think it's an incredibly valuable resource, as far as startups a concern. Yes, I think it is true that that the interest in startups has increased dramatically. And, you know, sort of in my family, I do not come from a business family. My father happened to be an entrepreneur. And so it was relatively rare amongst Maharashtrians, especially non-business Maharashtrians. Now I find tons of cousins, all of whom wanting to do something on their own. But equally, what has changed is the general drive for opportunity has gone up, and it's sort of like in my time, the idea was to go get a government job. So it's no longer now just a government job. Or it's a job where if it's not a startup, it's getting ahead. It's the idea that that you switch jobs, you don't start with with a particular company or a pot trust or a government. The age of 25 and hope to retire there with a nice pension at 60. I'm also not convinced that the best thing for India per se is everybody becomes an entrepreneur, because if everybody becomes an entrepreneur, then you basically have one-man shops, and one-man shops don't go very far. Mm-hmm. So for an economy to get ahead, you need a combination of some large businesses, you need some small businesses, some businesses which are in transition and so forth. So the real question is not whether you have more startups or more big companies, it's just how dynamic is the economy as a whole. Are the big companies looking for opportunities? Is the entrepreneur who starts a one-person shop or a two-person shop content to have a two-person shop, or are they going to hustle to become a 10-person shop? So it's the dynamism,
right?
Which is, and to me, it matters very little whether you have. I mean, Infosys and all is very nice, and I'm very proud to have been Nandan's friend and so forth. But to me, it's much more important from the point of view of economic growth that 10-person startup tries to become a 50-person startup, and it tries to do it in a manner that does not principally rely on bribery. And this, to me, was the most discouraging. I mean, you might want, I don't know whether you want to or not, but you discourage your class too much. But I've written a paper called "What Holds Them Back in Bangalore."
Oh, okay.
And this describes entrepreneurship not in the IT sector, but entrepreneurship on the ground, as it were. I tried to find the equivalent of the Inc. 500 companies in Bangalore. And it's a depressing business, because these people's businesses really have no real reason for existence other than the fact that they can avoid taxes which larger companies have to pay. Or they can avoid the labor rules that larger companies have to deal with. And I hope that changes. I'm optimistic that changes. But that's a much bigger deal to me than, I mean, what I would like to see is sort of Indian entrepreneurship becoming like Taiwanese entrepreneurship was in the 70s and 80s. Korean entrepreneurship was in the 70s and 80s, sort of a big upsurge of value creating, but not necessarily high profile entrepreneurship companies, which most of them won't go public, but which will grow, which will add value, which will do something interesting and different.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you very much, Amar. I mean,
you're most welcome. It's been a pleasure.
Yeah, it's been interesting to see the insights that you captured by studying entrepreneurship and real entrepreneurs systematically. And, you know, to a large extent, I completely resonate with it. In fact, I just finished reading a book called The Big Idea by Donny Deutsch.
Ah, okay.
Donny Deutsch actually runs The Big Idea as a TV show.
Right, yeah.
And he brings, you know, kind of interesting U.S. entrepreneurs to U.S. entrepreneurs onto TV, and he kind of highlights their journey and so on. And, you know, I think the U.S. obviously has a very huge consumer business, so that it's very easy if you can come up with a product that even 10,000 or 50,000 people are willing to buy for a certain amount of money, you can quickly become a millionaire, right? So, you know, lots and lots of interesting gadgets, interesting twists on, you know, restaurants, franchises, or food products, clothes, you know, beauty products, all kinds of different entrepreneurs were highlighted by Donny Deutsch. And I think your data syncs up almost completely that 90% of them had started their companies with less than $10,000. Even today.
Okay.
Even today, the majority of entrepreneurs, and these are not the, you know, the entrepreneurs that you discovered, which was the one-man shops and, you know, kind of self-employment. I call them self-employment startups rather than, you know, scalable, repeatable kind of startups. And but even the scalable, repeatable, real startups, which fall into your promising startup category, all started with, the majority of them started with less than $10,000, even in the U.S. today.
Okay. That's encouraging to hear.
Yeah, you might want to check this. I just got the audiobook. If you want, I can share you the link. And you can.
At the moment, I'm obsessed with medical innovation. So
yes. You need real money for that one.
Yeah, so I have to focus on what I'm focusing on. And,
Great.
This is a nice visit to my past, but this is not what I'm currently doing.
Okay. But still, I think... the students, I think, seem to have universally enjoyed it.
Good.
And I think it gives them a framework, because almost everybody in this class has started some business or the other.
Mm-hmm.
And they are just looking for a roadmap for themselves.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I think the insight you gave on recruiting, the insight you gave on sales, the insight you gave on, you know, the team, the traits, all very useful things, because that's the real world. The real world is not, you know, Silicon Valley startups hiring MIT grads and Stanford grads, right?
Mm-hmm.
Even though that's kind of,
unfortunately,
the model that is kind of hyped up in the press. Okay.
Good luck to everybody.
Right. Thank you very much.
You're most welcome. And good luck to everyone. Okay. Thanks. Bye.
Bye. Okay. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Amar. And let's focus on what we are going to go over today. We've got a ton of things to go over. And I'm going to share the screen. Okay, so we finished off Amar Bide's kind of overview of U.S. entrepreneurship. And you know, I kind of summarized what I got out of his presentation. So today we want to kind of focus on two topics. One is product development for entrepreneurs, and then marketing for entrepreneurs. We probably won't have time to get into, you know, the three companies that I started and the lessons that I learned for entrepreneurship. We'll do that in a future class. So let's just get started.
Okay, so this particular presentation is from Stanford University, and Stanford runs this course called Technology Venture Formation. Stanford University was kind of the first university in the world to start the effort of teaching entrepreneurship. And they started that in 1992. So they have now got close to 25 years of experience in teaching. And last year they invited four professors from IIT Bombay to a two-week workshop at Stanford University. And essentially shared with us all the content that they had developed for three or four different entrepreneurship classes that they have developed over the last 25 years, and the methodology and so on. So actually the entire BMC thing that we've learned over the last two classes is actually a result of Steve Blank, who was one of the original founding members of the Stanford education program. And he came up with this business model canvas to help entrepreneurs think of their company. Previously business schools were essentially only trying to explain business from the viewpoint of large companies, which already had departments and so on. And he found that, that kind of education basically did not apply, at least till the company till a startup became a reasonable size. This particular marketing is different than the marketing that you would study in an MBA program, and that's why it makes so much sense. Okay, so that's why the topic is called reality marketing, which is the job that the startup has to do is to figure out, is this imagination a representation of reality, or is it completely disconnected from the real world? And so let's take a look at where startups go wrong in their marketing, and what are the five things that really matter. So the number one thing they found out is that entrepreneurs don't even know what they don't know. They basically need to find a balance between time to market and completeness. So this is a challenge that all of you are going to face, which is, when do I take my product to market? When do I come out of stealth mode? When do I start? When do I do a press release? So the whole challenge for entrepreneurs is trying to figure out time to market versus completeness. I'll give you a quick story. I was on the board of a company called AppStream, and AppStream essentially had come up with a way to do virtual applications so that you can have one copy of SAP, and then everybody, and then it is streamed to everybody's desktop, and then essentially everybody can use SAP, but by licensing only one copy and maintaining only one copy. So looked like a wonderful technology, because it would reduce the licensing cost, it would reduce the maintenance cost, really be useful. And they launched it about a year and a half after they could do a demo, and they got the Best of Show award at
different conferences. They got the newspaper coverage and all kinds of things. And they ended up raising almost like $65 million. But 7 years later, they still could not finish the product and launch it in the marketplace. And when, you know, they were ready to finally launch it, everybody said, oh, you launched it 7 years ago, so we're not even going to give you any press coverage. So basically, the challenge for an entrepreneur is to figure out when is the right time to launch the product. So these are the five things that an entrepreneur needs to factor in. First is, you know, is there an unmet need out there? So when I looked at a few of the BMCs that you all have submitted for your idea, item one is really where a lot of you are having a problem, which is you don't seem to have a handle around whether the need is unmet or not. So one of the reasons that I shared with you the book, it's only 4 CDs long. So you should be able to finish it off in about 8 to 10 hours of listening. That particular audiobook that I've shared with you, The Big Idea, essentially talks of hundreds of entrepreneurs who found the unmet need, and then that was their ticket to becoming a successful entrepreneur, making millions of, creating companies worth millions or even hundreds of millions of dollars worth, right? So the important thing was to find that unmet need. And you know, most of these entrepreneurs found that unmet need within their range of experience. It's the things that they were doing day to day. It's the things that they were going ahead and they see a problem with somebody in their neighborhood, in their house, or whatever. So they basically were very familiar with the need, right? So that was one thing. The second thing is the big opportunity. And this is where I think we have spent a lot of time discussing the scalable, repeatable issue, right? So whatever need and the solution that you come up with needs to be something that is scalable and a repeatable business. And then, as we saw also in Amar's insights, that, you know, there needs to be a sustainable competitive positioning and advantage. And he came up with things that, you know, I've kind of been doing intuitively, but he's as a professor, he's put some nice words to it, where he talked about framing, where he talked about mimicry, where he talked about going ahead and getting the customer to nibble at your solution, where he can try out your solution in small pieces. So, you know, I think item number three is important. Item number four was, you know, whether the business is scalable. And item number five is always why us and why this is the right time. And very often the answer to number five is that you are willing to give up your career, you're willing to invest all your savings, you and your team are willing to do whatever is necessary because you're passionate about solving this problem. So the unmet need is, as you'll see in this particular, in that particular big idea thing, is that it's who has, which customer segment
has a burning need for your product. You know, and I will share with you one of the students, BMCs, after we do this presentation, and you'll see that the weakness in most entrepreneurs when they start their company is that they find it very hard to identify the customer who's absolutely dying to have your product, who's got this burning need. Number two, I just talked about it, is whether this opportunity is going to be big. And the way you figure out whether an opportunity is big by building a top-down model and a bottoms-up model. So one of the challenges when you come up with these new products and new things is there is no data out there that tells you anything about, you know, whether this market is big or small or whatever. So you have to go at it both ways. You do a top-down market model where you say, where you look at, you know, who are all the people who could need it? Then my product, you know, what can it, whose problems can it solve? And then what can be my share of the market? And then in terms of bottoms up, you look at your first few sales in Nagpur or Pune or with whichever customers you have sold to or the shops that you have gone to, and then you multiply it out, right? And do it. And so you can see that the total addressable market for semiconductors would be like $34 billion. But when you just look at optical semiconductors, it might be down to $3 billion. And if you look at the photonics market, it might be down to $1 billion. But it's growing very fast, right? So that's why you zoom in on the market that is the fastest growing. Now, one thing that you have to think about is, you know, where do you fit in? So this is a question that every investor is going to ask you. And are you a totally new market? Or are you an existing market where you've come up with a better, faster, cheaper solution? Or are you taking the market, adding in some functionality, and making it expanded market, or you're spinning out a niche market that you're going to focus on, and so on? So let's take a smartphone and you know, initially the smartphone was just a phone which had a contacts list and allowed you to take a few notes. But then when you added a camera, all of a sudden you expanded the market for the smartphone. And then if you took that smartphone and you hooked up, you know, a health application to it, and you only started selling a smartphone with that health application to people who wanted some fitness or diabetes or health or whatever kind of thing, then you can take that smartphone and reposition it for niche market, right? The sustainable competitive advantage is first understanding who the competition is, why you are better, what is your unfair advantage, and can you sustain this advantage? So generally, startups will have trouble with this particular slide. But this is something that you've got to continuously work at. That's how I look at it. So, you know, for example, when we launched at Opti, we launched the first chipset with integrated cache controller. Obviously, our competitors were people who had a separate chipset and a separate cache controller. And we were better because we integrated everything into one. So our unfair advantage was lower cost, lower power consumption, lower difficulty for people to design the product.
And can we sustain the advantage? The challenge was, you know, other people can also integrate it in. So we had to continuously innovate in that particular area in order to sustain the advantage by either reducing the cost or by going ahead and adding a more sophisticated cache controller because we had experience, or designing it so that it can work with lower cost static RAM chips. So all kinds of different ways by which sustainable competitive advantage is established. So the next thing is, of course, you know, you have to be different, better, faster, cheaper. And if you're going to stand out as a purple cow, as we saw in Chicky Chunk's case, you had to be different. And that differentiated position needed to be defended. And you can defend it, by, as this chart shows, by communicating it in a clear, concise, and consistent way. So you can defend this position by explaining the market in the market definition stage, in the opportunity and need stage, the value and the compelling reason, the competitive analysis and differentiated position. So for each of these, you create, you know, the complementary, you create the complementary marketing collateral for your company. So one of the things that, you know, I always require entrepreneurs to send me if they want an introduction to a venture capitalist is, okay, I say, send me your executive summary and send me your corporate presentation but basically I ask for the 2-page executive summary. And in that executive summary, we are trying to go ahead and explain who this target customer is, what is the need, and, you know, what is the product, and why this particular product is going to be successful against the competition, and what is our primary differentiation. So all of that has to be captured in this 2-page executive summary. And this corporate presentation or the will be basically integrated or a part of the business plan pitch that we will talk about later. I think on scalability, we have spent a lot of time, but the whole idea of scalable means you don't have to redo your marketing, your sales training, your product development, etc., in order to sell more. So you have to sell more with minimal additional resources. You've got to do minimal customization for additional markets. And then you should have something where you can offer, go to the next generation product in your product roadmap as you go along. So for your business model, basically you draw a diagram which shows how this particular company added value to the particular device, so every startup will have a different business model for your particular thing, and one of the things that you will do for your startup is to figure out what is the best way to communicate the value that you have for your product in some sort of a diagram. And finally, like, you know, do we have the right team with the right domain knowledge? And is there some discontinuity in the market for your business that enables you to get in? Typically, every time there are major platform changes, for example, the internet came in about 10-15 years ago,
that was a major discontinuity in the marketplace, so that because information was now at everybody's fingertips rather than having to print documents and email was kind of the first major application that came on, and it replaced postal mail and replaced a lot of telephone and so on, and disrupted all those industries. If you look at what's going on right now, there are an additional 4 or 5 new platform changes that are coming on. And this is something that we will have an entrepreneur talk about next week. And the 4 or 5 changes are, number one is Internet of Things. And the second one is cognitive application design. The next one is something called blockchain, which is how the financial industry is changing. So there are 5 different kinds of platform changes that are now disrupting the entrepreneurial world in the US, and which will also probably propagate to developing countries like India and China and so on very, very rapidly. Where previously it used to take 10 years before a platform change in the US started impacting situations in other countries and other economies. Now it's happening in the span of 3 months, 6 months, 1 year, 2 years, right? So one of the things that I wanted to do with this particular course is to expose entrepreneurs to where entrepreneurship and startups are happening in the US right now, so that you're the first to start applying and looking for solutions, startup opportunities for your local markets with these new technologies that are probably going to come over into the developing market. For example, I tell everybody that, the first generation of massive startups in China and in India happened with entrepreneurs taking breakthrough companies in the US and adapting them to the local market. For example, we all know about Alibaba, right? It had probably the world's largest IPO, $20 billion IPO. And that happened because Alibaba, which modeled on Amazon for the Chinese market, became huge in China, and all they did was clone the idea of Amazon for the China market. Flipkart, already worth over $10 billion, again, cloned the e-commerce platform, Amazon e-commerce platform, and raced ahead to create the e-commerce business in India, but almost 6 or 7 or 8 years after Amazon became huge in the US. So, there was a sitting duck opportunity for entrepreneurs to create or adapt the e-commerce platform business on startup for the Indian market. If you look at Shaadi.com, if you look at all of these are, if you look at what is the job, Make My Trip, if you look at, Make My Trip is a copycat of Travelocity, Expedia, whatever. And, Shaadi.com is a copycat for Harmony.com and other things in the US. So basically,
the platform changes that are happening in the US are going to come over like a tsunami into India and China and other markets now within a year or two. And what I'm going to do in the next class is expose you to the five different major platform changes that are resulting in thousands of new startups happening in Silicon Valley. So you can, and then we'll get an entrepreneur in Silicon Valley who had taken my class a year and 18 months back, how he has jumped onto one of those five platform changes to create his company. So, whatever idea you have has to go ahead and take advantage of market discontinuity, the changes in behavior it's going to cause, like social media, for example. Once Facebook came along and people started spending all the time on Facebook, the company that developed what is that company? The gaming company on the internet, on Facebook. Anybody remember that? Can you type it in? I'm just slipping my mind. Oh yeah, there, Farmville, exactly. Zynga. So Zynga jumped onto the Facebook platform to offer Farmville, and their market capitalization became larger than the market capitalization of previous gaming companies, similar like Nintendo or the people that make which one was that? EA. EA is another one, and I'm thinking of actually that MMS game, the Activision, THQ, Activision, all of these kinds, Activision, THQ, all of these kinds of companies that had been around for 15 years, and suddenly Zynga has got a larger market capitalization because it jumped onto the Facebook platform for that thing. Okay, so market discontinuity provides an opportunity, product innovation, clearly, regulatory and other changes. So clearly, like, you know, in India, we are seeing a massive entrepreneurial opportunity in solar happening. In the US, because of environmental reasons, wind and solar have become major opportunities. Electric cars like Tesla got an opportunity because the government was basically every state was willing to provide free carpool access to people that had no pollution. So regulatory and other accesses, other changes can give opportunities. So behavioral changes we talked about, people spending time on Facebook rather than on the internet. So you can see that as the ecosystem changes, the same activity that had resulted in a whole wave of startups 5 or 10 years ago, now again that those same kinds of activities can result in new set of startups. So these are, again, the five market validation filters. And the thing that you have to do when you go through your BMC is see whether you are answering all these questions. So, okay, we will do all this later on. Okay, so one of the things that I wanted to explain now that we have done this pitch is,
to take a look at one of the BMCs, because I have a suspicion that most of the BMCs that you all have done are going to have the issues that I'm going to highlight. Okay, so just a minute. Okay, so I'm sharing Kaushal's BMC. Kaushal, are you there? Okay. Basically, like, you know, his product was to go ahead and just a sec. Okay, so his product was there to go ahead and provide some new high-end grooming products for men, which are easy to use and which, you know, provide the best smelling product. And the primary question that I had was that with this value proposition, how is he going to differentiate himself from the probably hundreds of grooming products for men that are around, right? So if I look at this value proposition, I'm not seeing, you know, any unique insight that his company, Shepherd for Men, has developed. And if you look at Cheeky Chunk, you know, he didn't say, I'm going to offer colorful umbrellas. Because if he had said colorful umbrellas, you know, it would be very difficult to identify one market segment which has the burning need, right? If you look at the previous, the slide set that we went through, Okay, I hope you guys can see it okay now, right? Yeah? Okay. Okay, so if you look at this particular BMC, you know, when you define your value proposition very broadly, and this is a very common problem for most entrepreneurs, which is you define your value proposition broadly, and as a consequence, it's very hard for you to zero in on a customer segment that has the burning need, right? So if I look at, and I'm sure, like, if you look at your own BMCs, that is the problem that results in your BMC not giving you a clear-cut, exciting idea for your startup, right? So you know, when you define your value proposition so broadly, you're not going to be able to find customer segment that has a burning need. So here, you know, if he's got something that's a very good smelling aftershave and hair products and other products, then of course he can target 18 to 50 urban male with high income. But that 18 to 50 would be hundreds of millions of people, right? So he's going to end up with too many people for his product. When you have too many people for your product, you're suddenly going to look at your channels are going to be all the different channels. So your channels are going to be online, it's going to be stores, it's going to be websites, it's going to be social media, it's going to be advertising. So all of a sudden, the customer segment is so broad that, you know, every channel can be used to approach him. As a consequence, you know, how are you going to become a dominant company in that particular channel? So for example, you know, if Cheeky Chunk went ahead and did not zero in on urban females, young females who are fashion oriented, you know, he would be selling his umbrellas through all kinds of channels, and he would never be able to dominate one channel in terms of reaching that particular segment the right way. So he could reach the segment the right way because since he has zeroed in on young college-going girls, he knew that if he could get social media with the soap opera, with you know, successful models and successful film stars and others to advertise on social media, obviously this is what the girls would be reading. The press that he managed to get to, you know, was the same newspaper where these girls would be reading that particular section. And then he found the e-commerce platform where he could go ahead and since, you know, these kinds of his customer segment is very tech savvy, you know, they would pull the product themselves without having for him to push it. They would pull the product on the e-commerce platform. So you can see that, you know, once you go ahead and create a value proposition for people with a burning need, all of a sudden the answers about choosing the channel become so much easier. The relationship that you're going to have with the customer also changes, also becomes so much easier. Here you're going to have all kinds of, Kaushal has identified all kinds of customer relationships he can have, but what is lacking is, you know, something that shows a deep understanding of why that customer who has this burning need needs to connect with your company. So for example, if somebody was selling insurance to retired retired widows, right? If somebody was selling insurance to widows, now instead of selling insurance to everybody, if you say, okay, I'm in the business of selling insurance to widows, okay, now you'll see that, you know, that widows have very specific needs, and you know, the customer relationship with widows is going to be very unique compared to the customer relationship with any other segment. So with a widow, you probably want to have older females who are your salespeople, and you probably got to have a relationship that is based on connecting with that widow through different situations, maybe through religious organizations, maybe through other social organizations. But you can see that, but you have to come up first with a customer segment who's got that burning need, make it as small and tight as possible, find the value proposition that'll appeal to them, then automatically the channels become very obvious what will work and what won't work, what kind of relationship you're going to have. Once you've got all of that figured out, now you'll see that the resources that are needed to solve to come up with the product or service and the activities that are needed become really easy to understand. And then the key partners will become easy. Otherwise, everybody's going to be your partner. And then you'll also come up with innovative ways by which you'll develop your revenue stream. Is it a repeatable revenue stream? Is it a SaaS model? Is it lease model? Is it monthly payments, annuity, whatever? The revenue stream is not just sale of product. You've got to put your, I gave you at least about 8 or 10 different ways by which the revenue stream can itself become a competitive advantage. And then finally, the cost structure. You can figure out whether the cost structure can become something of a competitive edge compared to everybody else in the marketplace. So you can see that the BMC is not just let's fill up the boxes. The BMC has to reflect your understanding as to why you're going to end up with a business that's very competitive, sustainable, scalable, the customers are going to love your product, why it's going to be, the channel is the right way to reach them. All of that has to be captured and communicated in your BMC. And since all of you guys are running companies, I want to see that you fill out the BMC for your respective company, so that if I ask a question, you can go ahead and really confidently explain why you made the decisions that you made, right? So a company like this would basically be an unfocused company, and I call such companies twilight zone companies. They don't die and they don't succeed. You don't make money, and you just waste your time, and you never have explosive success, and you don't know whether to shut it down or just keep it going, and you think that next year luckily the sales will come in or whatever. So you've got no compelling logic and reason as to why you're going to be successful. Okay, so I wanted everybody to understand as to why, how you need to go ahead and take your business and your startup idea and look for that unique insight and knowledge of that very specialized business that is going to make it, successful, and make it something that you're passionate about, and you just can't sleep because you know you're onto something good. Something that is going to succeed. Who's Aarend? Who's Aarend? In case you're in a financial distribution business, products are common. Can you explain that a little bit more? Okay, I'm going to enable Time Mumbai. Yeah, what was your question?
In case you're a financial distribution, products and service provider or product providers or manufacturers would be common. Basically, what we try to do in this business at R&D is that we look at segments depending on finance, income, and the product. Here, you know, for profitability, we also focus on the lower end of the chain, we also look at the higher end of the chain. Because that's what creates a profitable base. Your presentation, so you mentioned that focus on very specific segment, but in our case, what experience is, you look at a lot of two, three key segments which are good for you, and then you see whether that creates a number which you want. That is what has worked for us. The idea was.
Okay, so basically, you're distributing some financial products, like it could be insurance, could be stocks, or could be something like that, right? So if you look at those kinds of businesses, you know, you can basically do two things. One is you can basically be, I'm going to mute you guys because I'm getting a lot of feedback. Just a sec. Okay, you're muted, right? Okay, good. Okay, so basically, if you look at, if you're going to be in the financial distribution business for insurance or stocks or something like that, what you're going to find is that unless you have some unique value add which allows you to zero in on some particular segment of users, you're going to find that there'll be so much copycat competition that your profitability is going to come down quite dramatically, very quickly, and you'll find that, you know, you have a business that goes into what I call the twilight zone, which is nobody makes money, right? So you don't make money, your competitors don't make money. And as a consequence, you cannot invest to grow. So the key in this kind of a business is, can you get an exclusive from some big company for distributing their product? If you can get an exclusive, then in a sense, what you've got is a competitive, a sustainable competitive advantage for as long as you have that exclusive. So if you cannot get that exclusive, then you're looking at maybe a very opportunistic business opportunity, and you should be rapidly, similar to the example that Amar Bhide gave of that Eagle recycling company, you've got to rapidly go ahead and start moving your value add to additional products, diversifying, or going ahead and figuring out something that'll give you a sustainable competitive advantage. Okay? Okay, so, you know, we've had about 2 hours of lectures. So let's take a quick 10-minute break. And you know, I would say that, you know, you can go ahead and discuss if any of you has read Did anybody actually go ahead and download the big idea? Okay, great. Did you have a chance to listen to it? Okay. 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 So so let's take a five minute break or something. Okay, I hear that you can somebody did listen to that particular big idea, but I really want you guys to listen to that big idea, because as an entrepreneur, there's nothing better than to find other entrepreneurs who have done similar businesses for you, maybe in the US, and learn the tricks that work for them. Because every market segment, and he's got, all kinds of entrepreneurs in the business, and I think it'll be a great value add for you. Let me ask a quick one, which is, do you guys want to just continue and, because we do have a lot of material to cover. So shall we just continue with the class? Yes? You guys say yes in Pune? Shall we just continue with the class? Okay, great. Okay. Appreciate it. If anybody wants to take a quick break, just go ahead and take your break, come back to the class quickly, because we will have the recording, but let's just continue on with the class material. Okay, so what we are going to do now is focus on okay, so generally everybody's got yes. Okay, perfect. Okay, so we're going to focus on how product development should be done by entrepreneurs. So since most of you guys are real entrepreneurs, we're going to move rather rapidly through this, but I just want to get some key messages communicated to you. The first thing is that as an entrepreneur, you're doing two things simultaneously. You're developing your product, and you're concurrently doing your market development at the same time. And the biggest mistake that entrepreneurs make is they say that I first need to get my product done before I can start developing my market. So market development does not mean that you put out a press release. It means something else, and we'll see what that is. And so both of these, product and market development, have to be done simultaneously, And these are, it's an iterative process. Now, the number one thing that the, okay, some people want to have this thing in full screen. Okay, so the number one thing that challenge that every entrepreneur, and I personally have faced it all the time, is building a market is very hard. In the beginning, you've got no customers. Your product is obviously not finished. You don't have a budget. You don't understand the pain of the customer, and you're an unknown, right? So this is something that every entrepreneur faces, right? So as a consequence, but on the other hand, what do you really have? You do have a team of superstars, which means you do have some smart people in your founding team in that particular business, and you have this vision of coming up with this game-changing product. And the question is, will customers really care about this? And so when you try to find a customer, you see that they only care about themselves. And they don't care about your desire to make your product successful, make your companies, make this, create a great company. And as an entrepreneur, and this is something that I think Amar did a good job of explaining, which is you need to really become more like an empathetic person, salesperson, which is you got to comprehend their problem, what opportunity they are looking for. You got to figure out what skills you have to solve it, and you have to genuinely care about the customer succeeding. So this is something that is not normal for an entrepreneur or for an engineer. Generally, we always think about ourselves. We don't think about the customer being successful and caring about his success. And we have to, just like a nurse, go ahead and take care, show the customer that we treat him like a good patient, right? And what we need, of course, is customers. Without a customer, you will never know, whether you are on the right track for your product. So when you are an entrepreneur, since you don't have a finished product, you have to market the company. You have to market the expert on your team. So for example, at Selectica, we had the guru of configuration technology. He had a whole bunch of patents when he had worked at Xerox PARC. And even though our configurator was not working very well, every time we met a potential early customer, we would say, look at, ask your questions to our CTO, Dr. Mittal, who is the guru in this, and look at all these technology papers that he has written and published at all these different conferences. So we marketed our technology guru when the product was not ready. And then we found one or two customers who were willing to go ahead and work with us while the product was being developed. And we had you to invest heavily in your bet that, this is the right thing for the product. So I'll give you a good example. So when I was at Selectica, we were developing a configurator. And since we were developing this configurator, we you know, had a vision as to what the product should be, but we only knew that, you know, the artificial intelligence portion of it, which is what, you know, our CTO was aware of. And so I remember calling on Siemens. Siemens used to make telecom equipment in the US. And so we contacted Siemens and I said, hey, we've got the world's best configurator. We know you've got a very complicated, complex product. And can we come and demo it to you? And, you know, we took our CTO along and he answered all the questions of the CIO, Klaus Strassmann. And, you know, we showed him how it was just a fantastic configuration technology. And then by the end of the one-hour meeting became 2-hour meeting, he was nodding his head and saying, I'm quite impressed with your configuration technology. And I said, okay, would you be interested in licensing the product? And he said, oh, no way I'm going to license your product. And we said, why not? And he said that, look, for me to use your product, I need to write software models for all my telecom equipment. And I'm not going to hire 100 software engineers who will take my telecom product and write software modules for all the rules. So, you know, he said, what I need is a model builder. I should just put in the parameters of the telecom equipment and automatically the model, software model, should be made available to the configuration engine. And so we came back and we discussed it within the company and we said, you know, we already have a pretty good configuration engine. Let's go ahead and put all our engineers, and we had about 8 or 10 engineers, and move them from the configuration engine to building a model builder. And so for the next 3 months, we took all our engineers and got them to build the model builder so that automatically, and then we called the customer and said, can you give us some telecom equipment specifications? And based on that, we tested our model builder, and then we said, I called up Klaus Strassmann, the German CIO, and said, we've got a model builder. Do you want to see it? So he was very curious. He said, what, you have built a model builder in 3 months? And we said, yeah. So we went there and we demoed our model builder. And then he brought in one of his engineers and said, okay, why don't you enter the rules for this new telecom equipment into the model, into this Selectica model builder, and see whether it works. And yes, the model builder worked beautifully. And so we were very happy with the success of our model builder and a configuration engine. And we said, okay, will you license the product? And he said, oh, no way can I afford, can I buy a product? After you configure the new telecom equipment, I will have to do data entry into my SAP ERP system manually of the product that you've configured, and there's no way that I'm going to hire 100 data entry people in order to enter things into the SAP, and what if they make mistakes while entering everything into the SAP model and so on. And we said, we said, can you give us the specs of your SAP thing? So he gave us access to his SAP ERP system. And after looking at it, we said, you know, we need to get some middleware that will interface with our configuration engine and work with this SAP ERP system. And in 3 months, we took all our engineers and moved them from the model builder to the middleware system. And 3 months later, we called him up and said, you want to see this middleware that'll automatically feed the configuration results into your ERP system. And we showed it to him, and he was impressed, and everything worked. And he said, can you give us the order right now? And you can see that we are taking our whole company, and our entire engineering team is being moved based on the customer's requirements. And then he said, no way can I go ahead and use your product. And we said, why not? He said that, you know, the way your product is designed, I will need technical people to use your configurator. My salespeople cannot use your configurator, so you need a front end. And so we went back and we basically told our engineers, we are done with the middleware, we are done with the model builder. Now we need an easy to use front end for the configurator. And we took all our engineers, and now they were writing the front end. And then after they wrote it, we went back again and said, look, now your salespeople can easily use this configurator. And all of a sudden, he brought in his salespeople, and they said, wow, this is very nice. It's so much better than what we are using. I said, wow, so now you're going to give us the order, right? And he said, oh, no, there's no way that I can give you the order, because how do I know how much business I'm getting using your product? You know, I've got no dashboard. I've got no reporting system. And we said, okay, can you give us some standard formats for the reporting system and dashboard? So he gave us some examples of what they were doing, and we went back and told the engineers, okay, no more front-end building. We need a reporting system and a dashboard for the configuration system. And in 3 months, we finished that. We again go back to the customer. And you can see that, you know, we are taking our entire engineering team and doing what this one customer was asking us to do. We go there, and he said, okay, it's all done. So we've got a middleware done. We've got a model builder done. We've got a reporting system done. We've got an easy-to-use front end, and we already had the best configurator. And we said, are you going to buy a product? He said, oh, I'm so sorry, but I had to make the decision about buying a configurator, and I gave a million-dollar order to your competitor, Calico. And we were kind of heartbroken at that. We had worked for 1.5 years, had dedicated our entire company's future to winning his business, and he had just given the order to our competitor. And so we said, okay, I agree that, you know, you needed to do that. But we think that their product has a lot of bugs. And can you go ahead and let us see what kind of features they have and bugs that they have, so that we can tell you, since we are the experts in configuration? And since we had worked with him for 18 months, he said, okay, but I cannot let you touch the competitor's software. So we said, okay, we will just come. Your application engineer can use your product, we will just ask him questions and tell him to try this and try that. And so next week we went back to Siemens with a list of, you know, 10 or 15 different cases, and said, try this, try this, try this, try this. And we found that
there were six key areas that the competitor's product did not work. And we basically, you know, got some amazing data about the weaknesses of our customer's product. So, you know, essentially by the second bullet, which is locking customers with step-by-step development and bet heavily, yes, you know, you can bet heavily, but you may end up still not getting the business at the end. But what does happen is that you do end up with a fabulous product if you honestly do the development and service the customer's needs. So, you know, after 18 months, we did not have an order, but we had a complete product, and we had something that, because we already knew we had a great configuration engine, but now it's seamlessly integrated into ERP systems and reporting systems and all kinds of stuff. And we also knew our competitors' weaknesses. So the next, but in business, new orders from new customers come up all the time. So the next order came up at GE MRI Systems. And, you know, Calico obviously was there. And we went in, and the customer asked us to do a pilot. And this time, when we did the pilot, not only did we do the configuration pilot, but we also did a reporting system. We also did the integration into the ERP system and everything else. And so since we had done everything out of the 8 or 10 competitors, Selectica and Calico became the choices. And then, you know, suddenly the salesman calls us up and says that, you know, the order has been given to Calico. And, you know, so I called up the customer, the CIO, and said, can you give me a meeting? And obviously, since we had done the pilot and everything for GE, you know, and we were the finalist, he said, yes, I can give you a meeting. But just to tell you, I've already chosen Calico for the product. I said, that's fine, but can you give me a meeting? So he gave me the meeting, and guess what? Now I knew the six bugs that Calico had, which were fundamental bugs in their product. And so I told the customer, told the CIO of GE MRI Systems that, look, I know you've done a pilot, but pilots cannot test the product in the real world that you're going to be using your product in. And Calico has some serious bugs in them that will not allow you to use your product properly, and you're going to run into lots of problems. And we gave him the list of bugs. It's like one PowerPoint present a slide. And we said, check it out. And he had his application engineers check it out, and boom, it failed. And then basically the GE CIO had no choice but to give us the order. And that was a massive order. That was like, I think, at least a $4 or $5 million order. And even though we had no reference customers, but we had a complete fabulous product, and we won that business. And so the next thing that happened is that I knew that for complex configuration for big companies, I had the world's perfect product. Best configuration engine, best middleware, best model builder, best user interface, best, and I also knew the competitors' bugs. And so I called my sales team in and I said, okay, this is what we have got. And from right now, from this day onwards, if you lose to the competition, then basically, you're fired. Simple as that. And you won't believe it, after that particular day, we did not lose a single order to the competition. And you know, that's how we became the leader in the configuration industry for high-end complex equipments. And you know, that was our stepping stone to getting a $5 billion valuation, you know, a year and a half, 18 months later. So you can see that, you know, the power of getting the right customer with whom you can develop product in lockstep, and now you have to go all in. So when we found this right customer in the right market segment, we bet heavily. We took all our engineering, all our money, put it on whatever the Siemens guy said, and ended up with basically the product that would ultimately give us the amazing valuation. And, you know, after winning GE, we won Cisco, we won Dell, we won IBM, we won Hitachi, every global 2000 company that had complex configuration. We won Reliance in India, Infocom in India, you know, company after company, we won, right? So that's how you basically win in the marketplace and become the world leader for, you know, the vertical market that you're tackling, that you're going after. So basically, like when you're doing product development as a startup, you know, you have to essentially get to this particular point where, for us, it was Siemens, where they helped us with the feature requirements, they helped us with the user interfaces, with validating our ability to do complex configuration. So this is extremely important. There's no way that I could have done, we could have built, taken Selectica's configuration engine and built all the stuff around it without the product feedback and the building credibility, and building credibility for our product. So once it's ready, now we are ready for paying customers, and that's where we started getting GE. And after we got GE, we got Cisco, and we got Dell, and IBM, and da-da-da-da-da. And all of these guys, you know, ultimately became references, and before you knew it, we became the top leader. When did your customer rectify the 6 bugs? Which is a very good question. Because sometimes what happens is that the bugs are so deep in your product that you have to rewrite your core technology, which is what happened to Calico. And, you know, which meant that they would have had to stop their marketing, stop their sales, and they'd become a huge sales organization and huge marketing organization and huge number of application engineers. And they were pushing a product that was buggy out there. And for them to go ahead and fix the bugs, rewrite the engine, and then replace it at all their accounts, there was no way that their customers were going to give them a chance. So Cisco was Calico's huge customer, and we won Cisco from them. So we won. Basically took all their, not only did we take new customers, but we went to all their existing customers and kicked them out of their existing customers. So in the next 12 months, actually, Calico went broke. After raising close to $100 million, they went broke because they had this, you know,
600 or 800 employees, and they were losing customers, and we basically wiped them out. So, you know, in business, you know, when you get that competitive advantage, and that's why Sun Tzu's Art of War is so important, you have to go and you know, win the war, not just the battle. And that's something that we will talk about, you know, as we go through marketing and sales, which is that winning the war is all about completely demoralizing your competitor, where they basically throw up their hands and say that, okay, we are out forever. And you know, so basically, like, you know, once you do product development like this, where in this sequence, you know, you become a dominant leader and can own it all and become very big. And that's, in a sense, if you look at what Google did to the, you know, there were five other search companies that were out there, which all had multi-billion dollar valuation when Google came into the market, and with thousands of engineers they had, where Google had maybe 30. And today, all those five or six companies that had total value, cumulative valuation of about $8 to $10 billion, don't even exist anymore, while Google now has a market valuation of $300 billion, right? So you know, in business is war, and you know, you can actually go ahead convert your competitive advantage into something that is sustainable. And if you're in a massive market and you own it all, now we're looking at becoming a monster, which is what, you know, Microsoft did that over and over again to all their competitors in the word processing business. Then they did it in the Excel, in the spreadsheet business. Spreadsheet was not even invented by Microsoft. Word processing was not even invented by Microsoft. Browsers were not invented by Microsoft. Operating systems were not invented by Microsoft. None of these things were invented by Microsoft, but they would wipe out the competition so completely by leveraging something or the other that, you know, by essentially using the Sun Tzu Art of War, that you know, they ended up becoming a monopoly, as Google has become a monopoly, and so is you know, so did Microsoft and so on. And it was only because of a platform change from client server to internet that we've got Microsoft, which is being forced to reinvent themselves. Otherwise, you know, they would come up with a new product and everybody has to use it. And they took away market segment after market segment by leveraging all their strengths. So the common mistakes for every entrepreneur is starting to sell too late, overemphasizing the product, and this whole big company product testing process, which is, you know, most, you know, we did have other configuration competitors besides Calico, and all of them actually got scared by item number three. So sometimes a common mistake actually becomes your
success strategies. So in this is quite fascinating, because most of the people who were similar to Selectica and all we had a configuration engine decided to focus on small and medium companies with medium complexity and did not take on the opportunity for big companies, because big companies are like Siemens, where their product testing actually ends up killing the small company. I was lucky that, you know, we were building a product during the dot-com boom. So even though, you know, we had no revenue for year one, year two, year three, year four, yet the VCs kept funding my company. And I ended up raising almost $18 or $20 million without, and they gave me that $18 or $20 million to keep supporting Siemens during all the tough work that they were making us do. So sometimes a common mistake becomes the reason why you're going to ultimately become a massive company. And some other companies fail because the launch fizzles. Very, very common. A big mistake that a lot of product companies make, and Indian companies are unfortunately the biggest losers in the product business, because it's so much easier to get a consulting project for a big company than to sell them a product. And India has become kind of the consulting shop for the whole world. And in spite of the huge amount of software technology that exists within Infosys and TCS and Syntel and everybody, there are no products. While with the 1,000th amount of software, US companies develop so many products. Ramping sales before product is ready, I would say that was Calico's mistake. That their product had bugs, but they ramped up the sales and marketing. They did all these promises. They got people to use buggy products. They were hoping to fix the bugs, but if a competitor comes along and is ready to compete with you, you could end up, you know, getting blown out of the water, because your cost of your sales and marketing and company overhead is such that you just cannot go back and fix the bugs in your product. Ramping development before market is proven, you know, I've seen that happen more often than ever. And so it's really important to kind of wait till the market is ready. Let's see. So mistake number one was starting to sell too late. So when you sell too late, basically what ends up happens is that you build the wrong stuff in the wrong quantity, and you deliver it too late and the market is gone. And so in order to get it right, you must identify the minimum amount of product requirements, minimum compelling feature set. So one of the things that we keep talking about is the MVP, minimum viable product, learning how to sell that MVP and seeking out early customer partners. So this is how mistake number one is addressed. So the whole goal is to get to paying customers.
And since this thing takes about 6 to 18 months, it's really important to go ahead and get that. So I already told you the case study about what it took to develop a market-ready product with Siemens Telecom, till if we had not had this customer helping us understand the market and the need, there was no way that we would have succeeded. Pinpoint market entry points with customers. So one of the requirements that a lot of VCs will do these days is they will actually want you to talk to at least 30 prospective customers while the engineering is developing the product, and understand from them so that you have this iterative cycle of listen, learn, and refine. In fact, at Stanford, right now, they're teaching an entrepreneurship course in a very interesting way, where before you're admitted to the entrepreneurship course, you have to go ahead and meet at least 10 customers for your project idea. And then with their help, define the product and then go ahead and if you do a good job of explaining how the customers help you refine and define the project that you're going to do in your entrepreneurship class, they won't even give you admission to the entrepreneurship course. So maybe I should ask a question. How many of you talked about your product or company to, let's say, instead of 30, let's have even 10. Can you lift your hands up? I'm seeing a few hands go up. Oh, wonderful. Awesome. I'm impressed. This is really the most important thing that you can do in order to really understand how your company is going to be successful. But that's excellent. I'm so happy. Overemphasizing the product. So this is probably the most common mistake that entrepreneurs make, because you know they're all engineers. They love and they love their technology and the work that they're doing, but they never get to the point where they understand the pain of the customer. So understanding why the customer's hair is on fire, why they must have your products. For example, we talked about that company that was going to come up with this new, better smelling products. I'm not sure whether they've talked to people who must have, who had a pain with was there a smell that they did not like in their existing hair products or other products? What was the thing that people were complaining about that resulted in the product, right? So let me ask somebody to explain to me, what pain the customer had which helped them define a product. I'm going to open that up. So anybody, if you have it, you can put it in chat and then we will have you ask the question. Can you tell me what pain your customer had which guided your product development? Anybody? Come on, you guys should know your pain, man. You, all of you are entrepreneurs. Yeah, go ahead. This is from Pune. Please unmute. Yeah, go ahead.
Hi, everyone. This is Santosh. I run a company which is into the market research space. I come from a business development sales background of 11 years. So I met a couple of customers, prospective customers, to go and sell market research to them. And when they heard my background, when they heard where I'm coming from, they asked me, why are you giving us market research? Why not help us with something which will help us generate leads? And that's where I found a new dimension for market research, wherein we can generate sales intelligence, basically create white papers for them, which they sponsor, and we create a huge subscriber base for a specific industry. And we are currently working with three of our customers who are into the IoT space, and soon we'll be launching white papers in the IoT space, wherein they are expecting leads to come in, and they're sponsoring the research. So they want to take a positioning of a thought leader. And this I'm talking specifically about SMBs, small and medium businesses. Their problem is they don't want to consume market research because it's too expensive. But if it delivers them leads or if it delivers them business, they are more than happy to sponsor it.
Okay, great. And you figured this out only by talking to them, right?
Yes.
Excellent. So I know that there is one more entrepreneur on this list, San Bhaskaran. Sam, can you, your company is, your startup is pretty far along with your CRM package. So tell me, what has been your experience with understanding the customer's pain? You have to unmute yourself, yeah. Unmute, yeah.
Yes. What we saw, the biggest pain we saw in our customers.
Why don't you explain uPilot what it does?
All right. So uPilot is a CRM solution which is positioned as a competitor to Salesforce, which is actually challenging all the legacy CRM solutions with a modern interface and a role-based security model, which is very, very easy to configure without the need for consultants. And, the adoption cycle and implementation cycle is reduced from months to few hours. So that is our biggest value proposition. The pain point we saw is the sudden drop in product usage by sales staff once the customer grew out of small business CRMs and moved to a legacy role-based access and security solution like Salesforce. So this is necessary when the business grows, because you just need to control who sees what information, who reports to whom, and what reports are generated. At the same time, they lose the flexibility, and people used to input data on Friday evening because they want to please the boss, not because they want to use the CRM. Mm. And the implementation time sometimes used to take months, exorbitant costs. And finally, they end up with a product where people are, to use the words used by our customer, the salespeople were whipped to use the system. So, it was not giving enough results that they were expecting. So they needed a system which would be faster to implement and high adoption by salespeople without the need for training and certifying people to use the system. And that's where we come in. We have many, about 30 customers from startup to Inc. 500 customers. We have a Fortune 500 company that is evaluating our product right now. I think we are in that stage where we are developing the product with about 30 customers in a private mode, where we are actually completing the product development from the learning we get from the customers.
Excellent. Yeah, great. Okay, I think let's have somebody from Thai Nagpur who's doing nutritious food. Tell me how you interacted with customers to figure out the pain. The reason I'm doing it is because I think the pain is something that everybody has to discover from their customers in different ways. So I explained quite extensively how
I got my arms around the customer's pain for Selectica, and by addressing one pain after the next, because it's like an onion where you take care of one pain, then the next pain comes up, then the next pain comes up. And only after you've gone and done a fair amount of problem solving that your solution becomes robust and something that is generally going to win in the marketplace. So pain is not a one-time thing. Pain is something that as your connection with the customer improves and as you solve his pain, you'll get the next layer of pain and then the next layer of pain and the next layer. So you can't say that, okay, I'm done with you. You know, it's actually you're becoming more sophisticated in your understanding and judgment of what is going on in the business, right? So, and that's what's going to give you a product which has got wide applicability and robustness and referenceability and you know, high ROI benefits for the customer. Okay, let's talk to the person from Nagpur who's in the food business, because as you'll see from the big idea, that food is actually such a massive area for entrepreneurial opportunity, especially now that India is becoming going, the Indian food market is going towards packaged foods, is going towards retailing, it's going towards, you know, lots of shop, restaurant consumption is now taking off instead of just people eating food from home. So it's becoming more like the US or the West. And unfortunately, it's not what our parents would like us to do because, you know, the food is not healthy and all that stuff. But, you know, that's the way the world goes. And I think there's, in my opinion, it's a booming, bustling area for entrepreneurial opportunities. So I'd like to have this person who's doing the nutritious food startup from Thai Nagpur to kind of share a little bit about, you know,
Okay. Raj, can I start?
Yeah, you're on.
Yes. Raj, we can see that people have a lot of money and they are educated also. But when it comes to food, they really don't know what is nutritious, what they should eat, what their children should eat. And typically what happens is that Maggi noodles is easier to get at home rather than any nutritious thing. So what we are trying to teach is what is nutritious, and we are also giving an opportunity for easy availability of the same.
Yeah, so tell me about 10 or 20 key interesting good customers or potential customers that gave you these insights.
Yes, we actually went to a college. We went to VNIT where we could find a cross-section of people, right from the elderly to the young ones. So there were some people who had the concern of weight control. They wanted to have healthy food and keep their weight under check. While other people, they felt that mess food offered by the college was terrible and they needed something which is tasty and nutritious would go along with that. So,
okay. did you find any specific segmentation that you could do among these customers?
Yeah, we found that office goers, college students, people who go to the gym, people who are recovering after hospitalization, So there is a whole lot of different segments which has the need for this nutritious food.
So of all those four or five segments, which would be your number one segment?
Like 4 p.m. snacks of office goers.
Office goers would be one of them.
Okay.
And college students would be another big segment.
No, but college students is a very broad category. You know, there's one lesson to learn from today's class. Segment, 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 segment. Right? I want you to, you can't say college students. I want you to take college students and say, okay, are these first year students? Are these girls? Are these athletes? Are these nerds? Are these, you know, people who stay in dorms, people who stay at home? I want you to learn to segment.
Yes.
And then tell me which one is your top priority and why their pain is so important.
Yes, it is actually those who stay in the dorms. They get the same vegetables throughout the week. Whatever is the cheapest vegetable in the market, that is given to them all the 4 or 5 or 7 days of the week.
Right.
So they are our target group.
Okay. So dorm people became your target group. Now see, one of the things that you have to learn to do is you have to choose your segment by a number of parameters, and where I think that picture of burning need, the hair is on fire, is a very good kind of visual image that you should have for your customer segment. So when you do your BMC, I want you to think, close your eyes and say, who's got the hair on fire? So you have to have that image in your head, and so that you can, and then you should understand that pain very, very clearly, right? Okay, good, excellent. Good. Let's see if who is NMIE? Who's NMIE? Hang on, let's find them just a minute. I saw Apu, I'm going to have you come on class next week when we do the IoT thing, okay?
Hello.
Okay. Hello. I cannot find NMIE. Who's NMIE?
Hello, sir.
Just let me find you. Yeah,
Hello.
Yeah, hello.
Sir, this is Amit here from Belgaum.
Oh, Amit from Belgaum. Okay, just a minute. I don't know why I can't find you.
So the screen with NMI, I'm setting in.
Oh, there you go. Okay, got it. Okay, perfect. Got it. Okay, now you're on the screen for everybody. Yeah.
So we are trying to work on a project which will basically solve multiple problems. Okay. Are you able to hear me, sir?
Yes, we can. Everybody can hear you. You're on the front screen. Yeah.
Yes. So today banks and NBFCs are faced with the problem of expansion for the last mile connectivity because the transaction costs are on a higher side. Just a rental would be close to 1,40,000 for a bank, and that means their per transaction cost is going up in the smaller places, townships with basically 25,000 or less population. Similar is the problem for NBFCs, where they want to penetrate, insurance companies where they want to penetrate. So the pain points which we studied from most of this is getting the last mile connectivity is very important to them because they would like to spread their base. Today, let it be micro insurance, let it be the banking activities. More and more people, even the government has started investing a lot in these activities. So after hearing to all these companies, because the customer also needs it. Today, a rural customer from tier 3 or tier 4 town is as aspirational as a customer from Bombay or Pune or any other location. You would like to have the best of the facilities given to him. So we found out that the ways and means whereby we can reduce the cost of these banks through a brick and mortar model. So we are working on it, sir.
Okay. So the pain was, so tell me what the pain was.
The pain was like today, most of the nationalized banks or the private sector banks, if they want to open a branch in a smaller town, is like the rental incomes and the manpower cost would be close to 140,000.
Right.
But in a town of, let's say 10,000, to get that kind of money, they need to churn around 10 crore per month, which may or may not be possible.
I see.
Therefore, we can come up with extension counters, which are privately managed to the current account of these people, very similar to a business banking correspondent. But at the same time, we also took into other factors into consideration, like this person in the small village cannot only survive by doing banking. Therefore, we are trying to integrate other services like insurance, because even insurance companies are looking at penetration, like healthcare. Health insurance is a big arena today. And most of the people are worried about it, and even the penetration of rural insurance schemes is going up. So we are trying to integrate this in a brick and mortar store, which would come in a 4x4, as low as 4x4 and a 10x10 area. Therefore, these would be lowering the cost, and banks would be paying us on a per transaction basis.
Mm.
Already, we have started testing in the invisible market, getting good response for it. Our branded stores would be launched soon, sir. We are working on it, finalizing the
process. Okay, so that's good example of finding a need. That's a good example of finding a need for financial services that is today not being serviced because of cost of entry, right? And there isn't enough business to justify the infrastructure for the business, but people still need a person, physical person and physical facility that represents them, correct?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so what you're saying is the pain for the smaller towns, which have only 10,000 people or less, is they would have to go to a big town to do their financial transactions, insurance or deposit money or withdraw money. But now you are providing a kiosk or something like that, low cost, physical facility to do it locally, right?
Yes, sir. We are also integrating certain other services, like we are looking at water and medicine also, and courier services. Overall, therefore, this would act as a one point touch base for these customers to get all their services, like bill payments and all, where even most of the telecom companies are finding it difficult to penetrate.
Okay, I'll give you a quick suggestion.
Yes, sir. So
Alibaba, basically, you know, they provide e-commerce, right?
Yes, sir.
And so Alibaba, you know, wanted to expand from urban to rural.
Yes, sir.
In China. So they found that, you know, the people in the rural areas are not very competent with placing e-commerce orders, right? Because of education and everything else. So they ended up actually setting up Alibaba kiosk in about 1 million rural locations. And they basically allow villagers to go ahead and order through that kiosk so that the delivery happens to the kiosk. And then the person comes over and picks it up. Right?
Yes,
so you can get advantage of e-commerce without having, these people in villages don't even have addresses or don't even have, you know, ability to place a, they don't even have banking capability. They don't have all these other, or internet is not good or whatever. So Alibaba went ahead and came up with e-commerce kiosks at over a million rural sites. And I've shared a copy of that article in one of the, I think in week one or week two. So you might want to check up that article, and you may want to add
e-commerce ordering or e-commerce services for your kiosk?
Yes, sir. We are thinking about it, and also we are thinking about lockers, because the customer should have an access and direct access, because we do not know, might be a, some other customer may come up and pick up the package. So a pin would be delivered. We are working on similar other models also, so we are working on that, sir.
Okay, excellent. Very good. Okay, so thank you, everybody. I think, let's see. What happened? Did I lose everything? Okay. Okay, so let's see. Okay, let me quickly go through the slides. I think if you guys don't mind, we'll take an extra 10 minutes. Is that okay? Yeah? Okay. Okay, one of the things that I talked about was, as a startup, how do you get your early customer like Siemens, etc., that we got, and all the other customers that you get before you have your product, is that you to promote your players. So we were promoting our CTO, and he had the credibility, and you know, that allowed us to build an interactive relationship with some, you know, top level customers. This is something that I already talked about, which is, you know, most of these very big customers are going to kill you with their testing process. For example, Siemens, you know, ended up, you know, getting us to do a work for almost 18, 24 months. And never bought the product from us because they bought it from a competitor. Because, you know, but on the other hand, we turned it around and made it successful. But sometimes if you don't have good financial support, you might end up getting going broke before your product is done. This is an example of how you do early product testing. It's just a flow chart. It just shows you the iterative process that is used. And, you know, big companies typically will always have product managers that are going to guide all this. But essentially in a startup, it's the founding team that needs to have the same mindset of doing early product testing. Very important to choose the right customer partner and making them referenceable. And the wrong customer is always somebody who's in the wrong market. And if he's or his priorities are not mainstream, which is very common, because these people who don't have priorities in the mainstream are going to want you to become a consulting engineer and make you do a lot of unique product development. And sometimes they have no intention of buying when the product is complete. And so you have to be careful when you decide to commit on getting something done for a particular customer. So with early products testing, basically you want your feedback, you want to select the strategic account, and you want to build your referenceable customers. So the key message is develop the market as you develop the product. Don't wait for product
available. Can you share the screen, please?
What is it? Oh, sorry. Sorry. I kept on talking without sharing the screen. Okay. Okay, my mistake. Okay, so let me quickly go through the slides that I just talked about. One was promoting your own player. The second one is to go ahead and figure out how to do big company testing. The third one we talked about is
what this early product testing and the iterative process that is needed, and then why is it so important to do early product testing. And then we talked about how to figure out whether the customer that you've chosen is the right customer or not the right customer. And these are the goals of early product testing. And so in summary, the most important thing is that you must develop the market as you develop the product. Don't wait for product availability, build credibility, and identify minimum compelling features, and make sure that your initial customers are strong references, right? So, you know, that was kind of the main things we wanted to communicate in this particular class. And so one of the questions that was asked was, do you mind sharing what the value proposition of Selectica was? So I will do an entire presentation on the three companies that I had started, that I've started, and we'll cover that probably next week or the week after, because next week I want to cover the new technologies and some IoT companies that are based on that. Let's see. So we have one question. Okay, one question was week to assignment. You did not have to upload it. It was just for you to work on. For week three, I'll go over the assignment right now, which you need to upload. Okay, so let's take a look at week three assignment. Let me share that screen. Okay, so the week three assignment is okay, this was assuming that I finished the case study. Okay, week three assignment. I'm going to rewrite the questions. So I'll do that tomorrow. And because all of this was based on the assumption that we finished off the three Selectica, Opti, and Dyno case study, which we have not. So we will go through, I'll redo these questions for a future week. Okay, Neeraj wanted to see the last slide again. Okay. Okay, so the last slide, Neeraj, is this one. Essentially just summarizes. By the way, this entire presentation is there in your portal. So basically, you know, these are the four takeaways from this particular presentation. Okay, one question was, do you think Selectica got bugs since, not Optica, Calico had got bugs? I think the interesting thing is that every competitor has bugs in their product and they always hide them. And the key to your success is actually you know, who finds the bugs first? Will you find the bugs? Will they find the bugs in your product? And then who goes out? It's like playing tennis. You know, when you play tennis, the whole goal is to find the weaknesses in the competitor. It might be his backhand, it might be topspin, it might be his lob, it might be his net game, it may, something or the other, everybody's got a weakness. And he may have that weakness, may not have the weakness yesterday, but he's got the weakness today because he's got a little bit of cramps in his legs or whatever it is. So every competitor has weaknesses. And your job is to actually find those weaknesses in order for you to compete and win. Okay, your slides are not shared. That's not true. The slides should be shared. I'll go ahead and reconfirm that the slides are shared. Let's just confirm it right now. Yeah, so the product development slides are right here. So product development for entrepreneurs is the slide deck that we just went through. Okay, what are the questions? Let's see, do you think? Okay, that's excellent. So I think the main thing I want you to focus on is, you know, really creating a BMC that reflects a successful understanding of your company and its business. You know, till you really understand the pain, it's not going to be easy for you to go ahead and build the right product with the right set of features and communicate that in the right way and beat the competition effectively. So all of these things are fundamental to your success and your ability to build a company that is going to have long-term sustainable value that can go public, right? So, you know, everything that we are learning right now is totally relevant to, okay, so San has done a job for us okay, so thank you very much. I think, we had a very good class with Amar Bire kicking it off. And thank you for hanging on for an additional half an hour. Okay, goodbye, everybody.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.